We have a Big Bang cosmology that defies common sense, let alone having any claim to be called scientific, because it defies the first principle of physics that you cannot create matter out of nothing. So the field is wide open to an alternative cosmology. There is one called plasma cosmology, but it's far from being complete because it still accepts the expansion of the universe and the standard model of stars and so on. A real cosmology must do much better than that. It must apply across the entire spectrum and history of human experience in order for it to live up to its alternative title, the Queen of the Sciences. Cosmology is defined as the study of the origin, history, structure, and dynamics of the universe. As such, it provides a global context for both our science and culture, so that it has been called the Queen of the Sciences. But despite the media hoopla, there is no real cosmology at the beginning of the 21st century. The book on the left says it all in the title and is required reading. It gives an alternative view of galaxy formation using electrical engineering principles and plasma physics. I'm sure that in future we will look back on the 20th century as an aberration, an escape from reality in the arts and science following the insanity of the First World War, when we fell back into mathematical mysticism instead of practical experiment and classical natural philosophy. And also, the fire hose of government funding that was turned onto science at that time has created a juggernaut that had already left the rails but is yet to hit the wall. If you want peer-reviewed literature, refer to plasma cosmology in the IEEE Transactions on Plasma Science and Tony Perrat's Physics of the Plasma Universe. Web searches on the authors found there will provide enough to keep many scholars busy for decades. The electric universe paradigm by comparison is interdisciplinary and gives a much broader context, which is necessary for completeness. The electric universe follows the tradition of classical physics and natural philosophy. It's a case of back to the future. It provides concepts that may explain the philosophical puzzles that still dog mainstream physics. Such things must be addressed if we are to have a real science and cosmology in this century. I don't want to dwell on the past, but it is important to give historical context in order to contrast the electric universe model with mainstream thinking. The differences occur at a fundamental level. Following the lead from classical physicists and philosophers, the goal is to simplify, to make use of repeated patterns at different scales, what some people call the fractal universe, and most of all, to just make sense, as many people remark about the electric universe. A significant problem comes from the lack of education about plasma, the most common form of matter in the universe, yet the least known and experienced in our own environment on the surface of the Earth. In 43 historical entries on cosmology in Wikipedia, plasma is mentioned in only one. Modern entries focus on creation of matter, unreal geometries, invisible or dark matter, and mysterious dark energy. It has nothing to say about life in the universe. It's all accidental. Big Bang cosmology is merely another creation story couched in mystical language. Science took a wrong turn in the 1920s and 1930s, and I'm not alone in saying this. Don Hodgson, who's also a member of the Natural Philosophy Alliance, said, "Everyone who takes relativity seriously believes in the reality of at least one direction in which one cannot point." I have a little video to show you later which demonstrates the point beautifully, and it's from a Nobel Prize winner. E equals MC squared is the best known and most misunderstood equation in science, showing that mass and electromagnetic energy are directly related. But mystification resulted when the earlier concept of related mass to quantity of matter was unconsciously substituted. Obviously, mass and matter start with the letter M, so when you write an equation on the board, it's very easy to mistake one for the other. Einstein bequeathed us a disconnected, incoherent universe that cannot function or give rise to life. Also, Einstein, in his special theory of relativity, postulated there was no medium called the ether. but Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism absolutely requires it. So Einstein, at a stroke, removed any possibility that he or his followers would find a link between electromagnetism and gravity. But it unfortunately served the egos of his followers to consecrate Einstein's ideas and treat dissent as blasphemy. Sometimes a concept is baffling not because it is profound, but because it is wrong. To appear before a chalkboard covered in mathematical symbols has become the favourite media cliché for genius. But mathematics is merely a tool. It is not physics. It's a great tool, you know, it can get you to orbit a comet and land something on that comet. As Douglas Adams hilariously noted, it's possible by using math logic, which often runs into infinities, to prove black is white and white is black, then go out and get killed on a pedestrian crossing. Mathematics may describe observed behaviour, it describes it, but it cannot explain it. Having mathematical laws of physics does not equate with understanding of those laws. Unless the physicist can explain the meaning of each symbol on the board in real physical terms and in plain language, the equations have no real meaning. In the picture here, it's Peter Higgs, the $13.25 billion man on the right. His notion that normal matter has no mass and needs some other external particle to produce mass is complicated and makes no physical sense. Why is inertial and gravitational mass the same? How exactly does the Higgs boson or warp space contrive to make 1 pound of sausages tip the scale at 1 pound? Yet the total cost of finding something in the experimental noise has been named, that's been named as a Higgs boson, whatever that might be, ran to that figure I gave you. We have a serious crisis in physics. Modern physics is useless for cosmology. Modern physics has no concept of how matter manifests mass. Modern physics has no physical explanation of gravity. It insists that light can be a particle or a wave, which is nonsense, and that electromagnetic waves can travel in a total vacuum. And quantum theory is not even physics. It's a recipe which works, but there is no understanding behind it. In fact, I should say there that in quantum theory, cause and effect are divorced, and this is the one of the principles of physics, that you cannot divorce cause and effect and still call it science. And particle physics is, I would suggest, not even wrong. There have been some books recently which have also suggested that. It's not just me. The most surprising discovery in my electric universe journey has been the lack of solid foundations for modern physics. These are all foundational. The fundamental questions that troubled all of the great philosophers of the past have been ignored, and the philosophers put themselves out of business in the 20th century by arguing about what is real. They started saying reality is all in the mind. Well, once you've done that, you might as well go out and get a real job. So physics is disconnected from its roots in interdisciplinary natural philosophy. Here we have some Nobel nonsense. This is wonderful. This is an example of modern physics from a Nobel Prize-winning astrophysicist answering a question from an 11-year-old student on an Australian panel show called Q&A just last month.
Thanks, Tony. I have a question on science for my son Lachlan, actually. His question is for Brian Smith, because he's very interested in physics. He's starting high school next year. And his question is, how can something as infinitely large as the universe actually get bigger?
Ah. Yes, this is always a problem, infinity getting bigger. So if you think of the universe, and when we measure the universe, it, as near as we can tell, is very close to being infinite in size. That is, we could only see 13.8 billion light years of it, because that's how old the universe is. But we're pretty sure there's a lot more universe beyond the part we can see, which light just simply can't get to us. And our measurements are such that we actually think that very nearly, that may go out, well, thousands of times beyond what we can see, and perhaps an infinite distance. So imagine you have an infinite universe, which I say is expanding. Well, that universe is actually embedded in four dimensions. It's this way, it's that way.
Watch this.
It's that way, and then there's time. And so as the universe gets bigger, essentially we are moving in this four-dimensional space, and we're sort of where something else was in the past, but we're in the future. And so we're progressing in this four-dimensional space in the future. And I always say there's a problem with four-dimensional space, is it's very hard to visualize. And indeed, I've never met a sane person who can visualize four dimensions, and you don't want to be one of the people who can. So ultimately, we're expanding into the future. But think of it this way. In school, you have done this little experiment in math where you'll put a ray starting at zero, and it'll go out one, two, three, and off to infinity. You put a little arrow. It goes off forever. Now, I can multiply that by two. So zero stays at zero, one goes to two, two goes to four, four goes to eight, and you can do that for any number you want, all the way up to infinity. And that's sort of what the universe is doing. Infinity is just getting bigger, and we're allowed to do that in mathematics. That's what's so cool about math.
Brian, your Nobel team not only proved the universe is expanding, but at an accelerating rate, and that seems to be critical, but what does it mean? What's the implications?
Well, it means that the galaxies that we see are moving away from us faster and faster, such that eventually they will be moving so fast away from us that the light they emit will no longer be able to reach us. So we will be in the future looking out into a universe which is literally void of galaxies. Our own galaxy, it turns out, is not expanding because we have a lot of gravity here. It quit expanding 13.5 billion years ago. But the rest of the universe will be accelerated out of sight. And so I will be unemployed in the future because there will be nothing left to look at.
Yes, you probably won't be around to see it. Peter, you made a point, I think, a quiet point to me while Brian was speaking.
Well, you know, I told you early on, physicists are the smartest people on Earth, and, you know, there you have it. So.
There you have it. That's one Nobel Prize winner to another. pardon me. Yeah, Brian Schmidt, I like the guy, you know, he's a nice fellow. In fact, we did arrange to have coffee once, but it fell through because we'd been having a debate in the local Canberra Times. Brian works at the Mount Stromlo Observatory, which is 20 minutes from my place, and I go up to their meetings quite regularly to keep an eye on them. But you see here the sycophancy that we have towards mathematicians. But as I said, mathematics is a tool. It's like having sycophancy towards people who can use slide rules. You really need to keep it in perspective. Where are the natural philosophers asking the big questions? What do you mean by these things? And of course, infinity is an unreal physical concept. So he should have just said that at the beginning. That was easy. It's like asking one of these guys, what is time? All you will get is examples. And they treat it as a thing, something that can be stretched or compressed or stopped. Anyway, what you do note, though, is that it's a bleak, dismal cosmology. There's no reference at all to life or anything like that. And mathematicians use infinity to prove black is white and 2 equals 5. It's called renormalization. It's when everything goes to infinity, so you open the window and check what's out there and then plug that in and keep going. That's what happens in stellar physics. And as I said, did you notice the direction of time? It seems to be curved. The irony of this is that the Nobel Prize award is for a discovery that supports the electric universe model of supernovae and is merely misinterpreted by astrophysicists because they don't understand intrinsic redshift or what that signifies. And I hope to talk about that before I'm finished. When we go back in time, some of the great experimenters and natural philosophers of the past actually intuited the real nature of gravity. And here we see Michael Faraday, and he says, "The long and constant persuasion that all the forces of nature are mutually dependent, having one common origin, or rather being different manifestations of one fundamental power, has often made me think on the possibility of establishing by experiment a connection between gravity and electricity. No terms could exaggerate the value of the relation they would establish. I agree wholeheartedly. Sir Oliver Lodge, as you can see, was operating at the time that Einstein became famous. He's a British physicist and writer, best known for his contributions to the development of wireless telegraphy. He perfected the coherer, a radio wave detector, and the heart of the early radio telegraph receiver. He was the first person to transmit a radio signal 1 year before Marconi did, and received international recognition for his work. Lodge is also remembered for his work on the ether, which had been postulated as the wave-bearing medium filling all space. Other scientific work included investigations on lightning, the source of the electromotive force in the voltaic cell, electrolysis, and the application of electricity to the dispersal of fog and smoke. He also invented electric spark ignition for the internal combustion engine, so he was a busy boy. But he was critical of the new theories of relativity proposed by Einstein. In 1921, Lodge wrote in a special edition of Nature, devoted to Einstein's general theory of relativity, and I quote, "The prominent merit of these relativity equations is that they replace any apparent predilection for forces acting at a distance by explicit recognition of a modified medium, or at least a modified space, in contact with the accelerated particle. The beauty and the ingenuity of this scheme and of the reasoning associated with it are apt to overpower the judgment at times and to lead to pseudo-philosophic conclusions which are not really justified and some of which are repugnant to common sense. It is scarcely wise to seek to interpret physically every link in a chain of mathematical reasoning." Referring to Isaac Newton, he wrote, "What is really wanted for a truly natural philosophy is a supplement to Newtonian mechanics, expressed in terms of the medium which he suspected and sought after but could not attain, and introducing the additional facts, chiefly electrical, especially the fact of variable inertia, discovered since his time." He's referring there to the increase in mass of particles in accelerators. That was in Nature, February 17, 1921. Lodge was fully aware that Newton's mechanics needed to take into account electrical effects on the masses of particles. This is a central idea in the electric universe. He also went on to say, "It may be that when the structure of an electron..." Now, an electron is supposed to have no structure. "When it's understood, we shall see that an even-powered stress in the surrounding ether is necessarily involved. What I do feel instinctively is that this is the direction for discovery, and what is needed is something internal and intrinsic, and that all attempts to explain gravitation as due to the action of some external agency, whether flying particles or impinging waves, are doomed to failure." So much for the Higgs boson and warp space and so on. "This is precisely the electric universe view, that the electron and all subatomic particles must have a structure that can store energy and distort to form tiny electric dipoles." So we get to matter and mass. Mass is a measure of the ease of electrically deforming a particle. This is what was discovered in those particle accelerators and was presumed to be just an increase in mass. But what is happening is, because the energy is stored within a particle is electromagnetic, the particle was accepting energy from the accelerating force and distorting. And in that process, it was absorbing more and more energy in distortion rather than acceleration. And this was misinterpreted as being just an increase in mass of the particle. Large particles are easier to deform and so appear more massive. The proton is larger than the electron. What about the neutrino? That's a much maligned stable particle. It has been detected, and it is necessary, particularly in this model. It has almost no mass. It's measured in an electron volt or two, when the others are measured in millions of electron volts, or a fraction of half an MeV. So I suggest, on this basis, that it's the most collapsed form of matter. So, the real meaning of E equals mc squared. I've put up the whole list there because, and I'll just run through them. The most obvious thing is, with that equation, that energy, mass, and the speed of light are all properties of matter. It's intrinsic to the matter itself. You don't have to look for Higgs bosons or anything external to give you these properties. Electromagnetic energy is stored in the orbital structure of subatomic particles and manifests as their mass. In other words, this is a repeated pattern. You take the atomic model, you take it down and you put it into the subatomic particles and you satisfy what Sir Oliver Lodge suggested and what Faraday suggested. And it's a simple model. It's the simplest you can come up with. The mass of a particle is a measure of how much energy is absorbed in deformation of that little solar system, if you like, instead of its acceleration. Energy requires the presence of matter. There is no such thing as pure energy. Goodbye, Big Bang. Electromagnetic radiation requires the presence of matter. It must have a medium through which to travel because the vacuum, so-called, has dielectric properties. Dielectric properties require matter. So Einstein, by postulating the ether away, actually has set us back almost a century. There is no such thing as a total vacuum. The speed of light is a measure of the inertial response of orbiting matter, in other words, the neutrinos, to an instantaneous external electric force. And it is characteristic of the material medium. We all know the speed of light changes when it goes from air to water or air to glass and vice versa. An instantaneous electrical connection implies a universal time. Now, the reason for saying that is that if you are going to have these tiny orbiting systems stable, each of those particles has to know where the other ones are in real time. You cannot afford the speed of light delay. Otherwise, the whole thing becomes incoherent and can't exist. So this shows that the electric force must act far in excess of the speed of light. Possible outcomes. One, the neutrino has almost no mass because it is the most collapsed and least interactive form of matter. It has no charge. And as we know, it can pass through light years worth of lead without actually doing anything. So if we have a plenum of neutrinos forming the universal ether, it is then the medium that transmits a transverse electromagnetic wave in so-called empty space. A light wave spins successive neutrino dipoles, so the speed of light in a vacuum is related to the rotational inertia of a neutrino. Antimatter is a misnomer, since matter cannot be destroyed. This is one of the other principles of physics. So the actual word antimatter should never have been coined. Matter and its electrical mirror combine to form a neutrino and radiate most of their combined orbital energy in the process. So if you have an electron and its counterpart, the positron, and bring them together, sure, you get a flash of energy, but not all of it is gone because what you end up with is a neutrino, which must have all of the component parts within it to accept energy and split apart to give you these particles reappearing again. But it's nothing magic. A neutrino may accept electromagnetic energy resonantly to separate into its component particle and mirror particle. Some more possible outcomes. The bending of starlight by the sun is due to refraction in an extended atmosphere of weakly gravitationally bound neutrinos. It's just the usual refraction of light. Nothing to do with gravity except that gravity forms the atmosphere. It's a secondary effect. Neutrinos may reintroduce cause and effect to radioactive decay. At present, that is non-physics. And there's no known reason why one particular nucleus and one particular atom in zillions of them suddenly decides to decay. But if neutrinos, which can pass through matter without being deflected, were to collide with the nucleus of a particular atom, which is unstable, it's in metastable state, then that could be the just enough energy to make that nucleus decay. You have cause and effect reintroduced. And so-called spooky or non-local quantum effects are due to instantaneous resonant transfer of information between subatomic particles via the direct electric force. This is why you have all of these spooky explanations for twin slit experiment and things like that. And you can use particles and have the same problem. What is not realized by the experimenters is that since all particles in the universe are connected instantly by this electric force, they are part of the experiment. So anything they do to affect the experiment knows about it. And this gives you a cause and effect for something at present that's just regarded as weird. Possible outcomes some more. Coherence at all scales requires this near infinite speed of electrical interaction. I'm not calling it infinite because, as I said, that's a non-physical concept. But it must be at a speed which is sufficient to cross the galaxy to the 100,000 light years in sufficient time that we do not see redshift changes from the center of any galaxies to the outer rim. I'll talk a bit more about that later. So the local universe is connected in real time by the electric force, the most obvious manifestation being gravity. And gravity must operate practically in real time, otherwise the solar system would fly apart. The sun wouldn't know where the Earth was at this moment, and all of the other planets, some of them would be divorced from knowing where the sun is by hours. That is an unstable system. All information can be held in matter resonances, so you then get into the realm of homeopathy and so on, and the weird experiments that are done which show that water can memorize something that's been in it. Sometimes you can actually tell it, give it information that it's never received. There's nothing being put in that water, but you can actually transfer from one test tube to another information. So information is held in matter as a natural consequence of these ideas. Living systems make use of information held in matter resonances in real time, and you then get the body-mind connection. It gets into the realm of what is consciousness, where does memory reside. And this last dot point is the critical connection between the electric universe and biology, mind, consciousness, Sheldrake's morphic field, and so on. And Rupert has spoken at our conferences, and I've spoken at length with him. André Assis, who's one of the, heretical physicists, argues that dimensional constants like Big G, the gravitational constant, should not appear in the laws of physics, because having these dimensions, they must depend on cosmological or microscopic properties of the universe. Dimensional constants mask our ignorance of the underlying physical concepts involved. Strong circumstantial evidence for a different gravitational constant for each body comes from the difficulty of establishing its value on Earth. Big G is the most inconstant of physical constants. Spacecraft perturbed by asteroids and comets, which look like solid rock, measure gravitational fields that suggest that they are insubstantial fluff balls. And we've just seen a perfect example. And comets exhibit non-gravitational accelerations. Also, by using Big G, measured on Earth, the planet Saturn appears to have a lower density than water. Big G cannot be constant because M is an energetic variable, and that's one of the dimensions in Big G. As I said, E equals mc squared, so depending on the energy of the environment and the response of the particular object, like a comet, to that environment, M changes. So that dimensional constant suddenly becomes very inconstant. That gives you the wrong measurements of density and gravitational interaction and so on. If subatomic electrical polarization is the origin of gravity and magnetism, I propose that G is a variable for each celestial body, related to the charge stratification within that body and its effect of electrical polarization upon atomic and subatomic particles. Remember that the particle accelerators, when you apply electromagnetic forces to those particles, the mass changes. Well, if planets behave like electrets and have internal electrical strain, you can change the mass of a planet by changing the charge on it. And this is important for putting together the story of Proto-Saturn. This means that the gravitationally calculated mass of a celestial body has no direct relationship to the quantity of matter in that body. And I've said that over and again this weekend. The mass of a celestial body is a variable, dependent both on the amount of matter in that body and its degree of electrical polarization, which is dependent also on its electrical environment. So, oops, we've got the wrong structure for the Sun. The stellar and planetary structure and composition are derived based upon the erroneous conviction that Big G is a universal constant. It's pretty odd, you know, we get carried away with science sometimes and we make something universal with very little evidence. In this case, there was no evidence. So the structure of the Sun is not the traditional one which we see there. Now we get to what causes gravity. This is the fun bit. Radially oriented electrostatic dipoles are formed by most atoms inside the Earth, with the inner pole positive and the outer pole negative. The reason for that is, as you can see in this slide, the nucleus, which is 2,000 to 4,000 times heavier than those orbiting electrons, will naturally, in a gravitational field, because of its much greater mass, tend to move towards the centre of the Earth. That means that the orbits of the electrons is stretched and you end up with a positive end of each atom and a negative end. It becomes a tiny electric dipole. And because all of these particles are free to move internally, they will all line up. That means that you have an electrostatic type of force at the subatomic level. It's not electrical, there's no charge involved because these are all neutral atoms in the Earth or most other bodies. So the result is that it's the sum of all of the aligned subatomic dipoles that produces the weak force of gravity. And that's always been a puzzle. The force of gravity is 1,000 billion, 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 billion times weaker than the electric force. And the reason is that you're dealing with the distortion of subatomic particles, the distortion of all the particles in that nucleus and the distortion of all those electrons that are whizzing around. It's minuscule. This is why we can leap into the air and the whole Earth cannot stop us from doing that. Once again, it's a case of a repeated pattern at the level of subatomic particles. So, if you've got charged planets, the gravitationally induced dipole set up an internal electric field and the planet or any other body, a star, becomes an electret. That is something that always has this charge on its surface. And like a subatomic particle, under the stress of an accelerator, the internal electrical stress sets the apparent mass of the planet. The extreme weakness of gravity, as I said, 10 to the minus 39, the electrostatic force, is due to the minute distortion of subatomic particles in a gravitational field. Catastrophism's massive problem. Velikovsky's, and this is a book by C.J. Ransom, by the way, who's in the audience at the back, Velikovsky's suggestion of an electromagnetic model of the solar system fails because the planets and the Sun are effectively electrostatically shielded from each other by the plasma itself. The plasma organizes itself so that there is no carry of an electric field for a strong electric field for any distance. But if mass is a variable, can it explain cosmic billiards? Crucially, electric currents may flow through conductive plasma between planets. It is here that the electric universe model meshes with the plasma universe. I showed this slide the other day. I won't go into the details there because we've talked about energetic neutral atoms and the circuitry and so on. But it was a confirmation, if you like, of the electric Sun model. So the solar system has currents flowing through it and there's current flowing between planets at certain times, and those certain times are when, in this particular case, we've got Venus here and the Earth here, and the spacecraft had detected these stringy things, which are over 45 million kilometres long. Of course, they're Birkeland currents, but the astronomers who discovered them didn't know what they were, so they call them stringy things. So it shows that current can flow in that cometary tail from Venus and strike the Earth. And also, from the Earth, it can strike Mars. And it's interesting, on Mars, whenever Mars was in opposition, you used to get this blue clearing where the ultraviolet haze in the upper atmosphere used to clear and emit astronomers could draw the surface markings quite clearly. If you had a blue filter, what was it? I can't remember now, but I did this actually with my own telescope. But what happens is that when the Earth lines up with Mars, the current from the Earth cleared this glow in the ionosphere of Mars. And also we know now that it seems to trigger these colossal dust storms on Mars. It's this electrical interference between one planet and another. But these days, of course, that interference is minimal. Each planet is a small cathode in the solar discharge. Remember, the Sun is an anode. There is an intermittent circuit for transferring charge from the inner planet to the outer when they are aligned with the Sun. If the charge transfer is in the correct sense, it will induce the planets to move apart into orbits having electrical least interaction. Quickly, it will appear as though the system operates according to Newton's laws with no sign of recent instability. So this is the stabilizing system. In fact, it's absolutely necessary because the gravitational system, using only one force, is unstable. So, in my opinion, this is the answer to stabilization of orbiting planets. And Venus, as an archetypal comet, now has the most circular orbit of any planet. Because it was discharging most strongly, it was adjusting its orbit most strongly. And the fact that it has the most circular orbit of any planet in the solar system now actually follows from this model. It was one of the difficulties that Velikovsky faced, because if Venus had been a comet within human memory, there was no way he could explain why it should have the most circular orbit now. This is my contribution to physics to give us a new cosmology. The idea of modified Newtonian dynamics was created in 1983 by Israeli physicist Mordechai Milgrom. He called it modified Newtonian dynamics, or MOND for short. It's a theory that proposes a modification of Newton's laws to account for the observed properties of galaxies. The theory's original motivation was to explain the fact that the velocities of stars in galaxies was observed to be larger than expected based on Newtonian mechanics. It's a mathematical theory with no physical explanation, like general relativity. So I've had many questions about Proto-Saturn's capture, and I didn't have enough time, or didn't spend enough time on the breaking news or talking about Proto-Saturn to show you what was going on. This is Proto-Saturn and Venus, Mars and Earth. I tried to give it some sort of idea of scale, but you can imagine that Proto-Saturn changed from being a star or anode in interstellar space to become a cathode or cometary body in the Sun's heliosphere. All the bodies within the heliosphere act as cathodes. And if they're moving on a highly elliptical orbit, in this case, Proto-Saturn was approaching the Sun, so it was certainly on a highly elliptical orbit, then it will discharge like a comet. And like all cathodes, surface material is electrically ejected and the body may fragment under internal electrical stress. Remember, the interior of the star will be positively charged, the exterior will be more negatively charged. And as you may expect on this model, astronomers note that there is a brown dwarf desert close to bright main sequence stars. This is what you would expect from this model. They're steadily losing electrons and mass, because if you lose the electrons or the negative charge from the outside of the body, then the electrical stress is reduced between the outside and the inside, and the result is that the body appears to lose mass. And to maintain the energy equations, you have to accelerate Saturn. Saturn has to accelerate to maintain the momentum and kinetic energy that it had. So Proto-Saturn is accelerated away from its satellites, and that's why they fell behind, because they're not being accelerated. In fact, they're now in the discharge column of this major comet. And they're accepting electrons, so they're getting heavier. They'll tend to move away from Saturn. So the satellites trail behind, and the cometary discharge of Proto-Saturn forms the polar column. Here's Halton Arp, who's been called the modern Galileo. Unfortunately, he's died recently, but he deserves a presentation solely on his own, on his work. I recommend his several YouTube videos, and in particular those DVDs of the Cosmology Quest. He was an outstanding student of Edwin Hubble. Without qualification, he is the modern equivalent of a Kepler or Galileo. He has empirically shown that the Big Bang theory of an expanding universe is nonsense. Faint objects are intrinsically redshifted. Arp produced the standard reference works on peculiar galaxies, and while compiling these works, he's noticed a significant clustering of faint, highly redshifted objects known as quasars near galaxies with low redshift and unusual activity in their cores. But this confronted astronomers' beliefs, so like Galileo, he was forced to desist from pursuing his research. His telescope time was withdrawn, despite the fact that he was a leading astronomer up to that point, and he left the USA for Germany, where room was made for him at the Max Planck Institute. Ironically, the MPI, Max Planck Institute, is the home of X-ray astronomy, where the electrical nature of the universe is clearest. Researchers there were able to provide further information or confirmation for Arp's views. If astronomy were a science, the final end of the Big Bang would have resulted from a paper released on the 10th of September 2004, which reported the discovery of a high redshifted quasar being ejected from the nucleus of a spiral galaxy of low redshift. He discovered redshift does not signify the speed of recession alone. There is some Doppler shift, but it's of relatively little significance compared with the intrinsic redshift. The universe did not begin with a bang. He found the redshift is mainly a measure of the youthfulness of an object, and this comes into the energy levels of the matter within the object. And as I've shown, the energy levels within the matter is related to the mass. So if the mass of the electron or the proton or the neutron, any of those, is different, you will get redshift if that the mass is lower. And it appears that these objects are born from the centers of active galaxies with lower mass. In fact, almost no mass to start with. They come out, shot out like a shot out of a gun, but then they increase in mass, but they do so in quantum steps. Remember, all of these particles are resonances. They're in resonance, so the changes must occur from one resonant state to another. It can't just gradually change from one to the other. And the fact of having quantized redshift destroys the idea that redshift is related to distance. So, yes, he found these quantum redshift effects on a galactic scale, and that puts paid to the idea that quantum theory only applies to the subatomic. Here we've got quantum effects on a galactic scale. This is a picture of his family hierarchy, if you like, because once you work that out, you can see that more blue-shifted galaxies, like in relation to us, the Andromeda galaxy is blue-shifted, so it's older than us. It's not going to crash into us in a few million years. The blue shift says no, it was maybe apparent. Neutrons and protons escape first from the active galaxy, followed by a jet of electrons. So the initial ejection of this matter with very low mass, that mass increases over time because the electrons catch up and they start to polarize this more positively charged matter, and the mass increases. The quasar increases in mass and brightness and slows down to become a companion galaxy. It has almost biological overtones, which is also rather satisfying. So, the electric universe. The electric cosmology offers a breakthrough in understanding of our real place in the universe. It provides practical insights for both scientific and cultural progress, because it ties in with our oldest stories, and a better focused space exploration. The electric universe is a convergent, interdisciplinary cosmology that attempts, in the words of E.O. Wilson, consilience, or the unity of knowledge. This is instead of all the compartmentalization and specialization. I've briefly covered the EU cosmology from the subatomic to the galactic. Of course, there's much more I could say and even much more work to do. My aim is to inspire those among you who will become the leaders of tomorrow to choose some part that interests you. You may not think you are a leader. For most of my life, I thought only to support those I considered the leaders. It was only when they had gone and I looked about me at the fateful conference in Portland in 1994 that I realised I had to lead. It's been the greatest challenge and the greatest adventure of my life. You should try it. Thank you.